Penguin Random House Audio presents Jack Kemp, the Bleeding Heart Conservative Who Changed America by Morton Kondracke and Fred Barnes. This is Morton Kondracke. Introduction. Jack Kemp was the most important politician of the 20th century who was not president, certainly the most influential Republican. No one has yet written the story of his impact on America and the world. His life and legacy need to be recognized, and that's starting to happen. In this era of political bleakness, both Republicans and Democrats are citing him as a model of what politicians ought to be. That is one of the four reasons why we've written this book. Above all, Jack Kemp merits a prominent place in American political history because he was Congress's foremost advocate for supply-side economics and the man who steered Ronald Reagan toward adopting it. Hence, he deserves partial credit for not only pulling America out of the deep malaise of the 1970s, but also helping to win the Cold War and convert much of the world to democratic capitalism. The 1970s were a dismal decade. It was the era of stagflation, simultaneous high unemployment and soaring inflation, and also of geopolitical reverses. It was the post-Vietnam era when the Soviet Union invaded Afghanistan, its Cuban allies advanced in Africa and Central America, and revolutionary Iran held Americans hostage for 444 days. And it was an era of bottomed-out national morale, its nadir when President Carter blamed the acquisitiveness of the American people for the country's seemingly incurable ills. In the 1980s, it all turned around. The misery index, unemployment plus inflation, fell from 23 in 1980 to 7.7 in 1986. The Soviet Empire retreated, tried to reform itself, and then collapsed. Among American citizens, satisfaction with the condition of the country rose from a low of 12% in July 1979 to 69% in June of 1986. And around the world, especially in Eastern Europe, but also in Latin America and Asia, democratic capitalism was deemed to be the end of history. Jack Kemp was at the center of the great turnaround. He did not invent supply-side economics, the combination of lower tax rates, particularly on individual income and a stable dollar. That was the work of two young economists, Robert Mundell, later a Nobel Prize winner, and Arthur Laffer. But once converted by journalist agitator Jude Winiski of the Wall Street Journal, Kemp became the leading political evangelist of the supply-side movement. Lowering tax rates, he argued, would create incentives for work, savings, and investment, and produce booming growth in a way that Keynesian public spending programs had not. His tax bill, Kemp-Roth, a three-year, 30% across-the-board cut borrowed from John F. Kennedy's 1963 proposal, became the vehicle for the supply-side revolution. Kemp's enthusiasm for supply-side economics was contagious, and he spearheaded a national movement that amounted to both a political and intellectual revolution in economics. In Congress, senior Republicans resented the presumptuous backbencher, still in his 40s, who was treading on tax turf. They also doubted his economics. But junior Republicans, unhappy with their party's lack of vitality, joined Kemp's campaign. Among them, future Speaker Newt Gingrich and the future Senate Majority Leader Trent Lott, future Senators Connie Mack and Dan Coats, and longtime party leader Vin Weber. Kemp forged links with policy thinkers in Washington and New York, including Irving Kristol and Mundell, and Robert Bartley, editorial page editor of the Wall Street Journal. Kemp's office and living room became scenes resembling graduate seminars, where the Washington-New York nexus came together for debate, but with major policy change as its aim. That aim was achieved. Kemp-Roth became official party policy in 1978. Even GOP graybeards, who had previously scorned him, signed on. Then he recruited Ronald Reagan, who made Kemp's proposal a centerpiece of his 1980 presidential campaign and once elected the basis of Reaganomics. The Reagan tax cuts of 1981 and 1986, reducing the top rate from 70% to 50% and then 28%, set off an economic boom that lasted into the 2000s. The achievements of the 1980s were mainly Reagan's, but their economic underpinning was Kemp's. No Republican politician of the 20th century who was not president transformed the country the way he did. Not Henry Cabot Lodge, Robert Taft, or Nelson Rockefeller. Earl Warren did, but as Chief Justice, not as Governor of California. Nor did any Democrats, except possibly Hubert Humphrey, the leading early advocate for civil rights, and Edward Kennedy, author or bipartisan co-author of dozens of health, education, and civil rights laws. Our second reason for writing about Kemp is that he embodied a spirit sorely missing in today's politics, in both parties. Kemp was positive, optimistic, idealistic, energetic, growth and opportunity-oriented. He was incapable of personal attack and negative campaigning, even when it cost him. The purpose of politics, he said, is not to defeat your opponent as much as it is to provide superior leadership and better ideas than the opposition. He criticized liberals and Democrats, but also green eyeshade, austerity-minded, Herbert Hoover Republicans. His criticisms were always based on their ideas and policy proposals, never their motives or personal flaws. He believed, as he said again and again, that ideas change history. He wanted to change history for the better. He wanted his own party to once again be the party of Abraham Lincoln. Even before very conservative audiences, he argued that the GOP should again become the natural home of African Americans, as it had been from Lincoln's time to Franklin Roosevelt's. He insisted it could happen if Republican policies brought growth and prosperity to inner cities. It was unrealistic, probably romantic, but it was sincere. It was famously said of him that as a pro football star, he had showered with more African Americans than most Republicans had ever met. He lamented that his party had been largely absent from the civil rights movement and regarded the Southern strategy to win white votes at the expense of blacks a disgrace. Kemp believed in what he called the American idea, that the Declaration of Independence was a universal document, that everyone everywhere deserved the right to advance as far as his or her talent and effort would lead. The American idea was Kemp's version of Lincoln's bedrock principle that the right to rise was the central idea of the United States and applied to black slaves as well as to white workers. And like Lincoln, he believed it was the job of government to enable people to achieve their aims and remove obstacles, especially, in Kemp's view, high taxes. We hope this book will inspire, or embarrass, present-day politicians to see there is a better way to conduct their business. To fight, yes, but over ideas for making America better, and to search for common ground to solve America's problems and secure a future for every citizen. Our third reason for writing this book is simply that Jack Kemp led a fascinating, inspiring life. His father, Paul, was his model of entrepreneurial capitalism. His well-educated mother, Frances, was his cultural and intellectual spur. They both were Christian Scientists, which produced in Kemp a lifelong optimism, a faith that thinking positively can change the future, that failure is never final, that when one door closes, another opens. Kemp grew up a sports fanatic, deciding at age 5 that he wanted to be a professional quarterback. By will and determination, he overcame repeated obstacles and became one, a star quarterback, first for the San Diego Chargers, then the Buffalo Bills. He remained a quarterback in mentality all his life. He was a natural leader, the captain of nearly every team he ever joined, and president of the American Football League Players Association. In the turbulent 1960s, he fostered racial integration of AFL teams and cities. He never stopped applying lessons from football to life and politics. Quarterbacking as capitalism, the huddle as cooperative endeavor, booing as no big deal, the next play as a chance to win. He was a physical education major and a mediocre student at California's Occidental College, but he became a self-taught intellectual, deeply read in economics, an expert in defense and foreign policy, and an avid consumer of history books, especially biographies of his heroes, Lincoln and Winston Churchill. After Reagan won the presidency, Kemp became the number 3 leader of House Republicans. He was a Reagan loyalist, but had the courage to oppose his president, and took heat for it when he thought Reagan was being led astray on economic and foreign policy. In 1988, he was deemed by many to be Reagan's natural political heir. He ran for president urging voters to join.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.